over the years, I became one of those people I never thought I would be, which is a person who, left to my own devices, I have a brooding aspect. But I didn't grow up with a brooding aspect. I was the opposite of that person. So it's a very strange thing. It's almost like the weight of what I do reveals itself in the off moments,
yeah,
where I'm not polished or I'm not presenting actually what I would like to present, which is positive outlook.
Mr. Happy-go-lucky.
Yes. Feel good. Dr. Feel good.
It's been a while. How long has it actually been since you got in the saddle to this degree?
Well, you know, I've made several things in the years between the house I live in and now, but they're smaller things. Like, I made a thing for The New Yorker, a thing for Amazon. But this one was, you know, I guess the last film was 13, so this is now 5 years.
That's a long time.
Yeah.
Did it feel like a long time, or were you just busy living?
It's a rather epic subject, and so the subject, you know, it grows to the size of its cage, and the size of the cage in this subject was global and rather large, historical and present day, and take that all on. And of course, that movie premiered a year ago, so it was in a different form then, and needed to be. It wasn't done. So I had a tremendous amount of work still to do to get to where I am now.
So how long did you, how long ago did you start?
I started filming in 2015, at the end of 2015, shot through 2016. And then we're editing between 2017 and now.
And there was a lot of prep before that started?
So I would say right around the time that I was touring with The House I Live In is where this idea emerged. Mm. And then it's been the time since then to get it out.
Because I've quoted you 3 million times about The House I Live In, and you saying you were going to, like, actually, you'd said at that point you were going to stop for a while and work on that issue.
And which I did.
Which you did. And not, you know, focus on jumping to the next film instantly.
Did that. And so, still do that. That's still been a big part of my life.
So this movie, what was the first inkling of this idea?
I was on the road with The House I Live In, and I was making speeches in all manner of setting, and Americans were so stunned by the conditions that had even befallen us then. This was before Trump. Mm-hmm. The country was already in such a state of disillusionment about so many things. And when I talked to people, and one day I just said, well, it's like we've all become the Fat Elvis, you know, like overnight. We woke up and where did everything go? You know, this young country had suddenly become middle-aged and a crisis, and where did the years go? And I felt a little bit like that as a person. So it was easy for me to talk about. And then it was easy to share it with people who I thought might be feeling the same about themselves or about the country. And then in one particular audience, an older man said to me afterward, he came up at the end of the question and answer, and he said, is that your next movie? And I said, what? He says, well, the whole Fat Elvis thing you talked about, that really resonated with me. Mm. And I said, you know, it's funny, I've been noticing that it reaches people, this idea, but I hadn't thought of it as a movie, it just was an idea. And then I thought, well, how do you explore that idea on film? And the first idea wasn't the road trip. That wasn't a match. That wasn't where my head first went. Although I suppose there was some road. There's been a road trip in almost all my movies. I travel a lot with my movies, but there was a sense here that you could. There was a metaphor to explore, and if you explored that metaphor for good and for bad, you'd run into the contours of the American story, one way or another.
So were you? One of the descriptions people have had of the film along the way are that it's there, that, you know, not that it wanders, that's not right the word, right word either, but that it's like, it's not a settled treatise, it is a journey that you're experiencing each of these pieces, and slowly they're coming together for each person as they come together. Was that your idea of it from the beginning, or did you want it to be more?
Well, because I've had a vision, I thought nothing could be worse than subjecting an audience for 100 minutes to my vision. I mean, who wants to hear that? So you wanted instead to live on the edge and have the film be a living, breathing, turn left and it goes one way, turn right and it goes another way. Sort of like choose your own adventure. And in that way, you know, it always sounds like a cliche when you ask an artist something and they say, I didn't choose the film chose me, or I didn't choose the Mona Lisa, she chose me. Or it, some degree of that was kind of true here. We went out on the road without a plan. I knew Elvis's life, and I knew how much he spoke to me about the American story, and I even saw parallels in his origins and our origins, and his rise and our rise, and his struggles and our struggles. That was all clear, but that doesn't speak to where you drive the car. Well, how do you, where do you turn to get that across or to explore that?
Mm-hmm.
Well, we started at the beginning. So we started in his birthplace, which is the most unoriginal, but the most organic place to start. But beyond that, it was like, where are we going to go from here? Well, where did Elvis go? It's sort of, what would Jesus do? Where did Elvis do this? Where did Elvis do that? But it's not a biopic. So I was only interested in where Elvis would take us. And then life is what happens to you when you're busy making other plans. We then show up in Memphis. Well, what do you do in Memphis? And who do you want to meet in Memphis? And what's the soul and the core issues of Memphis? A struggling, beautiful, compromised, forsaken southern town that was once this epicenter where, as Chuck D says in the film, it was the hub of everything in America, north, south, east, and west, all converging there. And you'd hardly know it now to feel the abandonment of a place like Memphis by the outside world. So there we go, we're already off and running, and now the metaphor and the sort of poetry of it starts to happen to you, and then who's going to get in your car, and this sort of great casting office in the sky turns up and says, well, here's some amazing kids from the Stax Music Academy singing precisely the kind of incredibly inspiring gospel that Elvis would have been weaned on, and that he would have then sort of drew from. Some people would say he stole, other people would say it was like a tribute. But Elvis is marinated in that culture, so the car gets filled with those kids, and we're driving at 60 miles an hour through the highways and byways around Memphis with these kids singing incredible gospel and soul.
And was that a circumstance? I mean, do you, just in terms of the functionality of that particular thing, for instance, sure. Eddie, for instance, do you go to Memphis and you kind of wander into them? Did you know they existed before?
I don't want to sound like I don't want to sound like an unprepared idiot, but
I want you to.
There's a virtue to just showing up. Woody Allen said 95% of life is just showing up. You know, some of the places where we did make a plan in advance, those best laid plans, they always go wrong. The ones where, you know, there's a young girl in the film, Emmy Sunshine, and her band, The Rain, which is her family, her uncle, her brother, and her father. And this music is written by her wonderful mother. I didn't know those people from Adam when I showed up in Nashville. I didn't know anybody in Nashville. And suddenly, within hours, one person said something to one person, another, and you're sitting in Elvis's car. And all of a sudden, this beautiful young Appalachian music genius young girl, Emmy Sunshine, is sitting in your car with you, and her family is playing the most beautiful music you can imagine. The back
of Elvis's
car.
So somebody said you should go see her or go find her?
Somebody said there's a young girl in town who's a real wunderkind, and she actually doesn't live in Nashville. She lives in Knoxville. But maybe they'd come in. Maybe this would be interesting to them. So all of a sudden I was on the phone with them, and 2 hours later she was getting her, you know, her hat fixed to be ready to be filmed in the car, and she blew us away. You know, I was crying during part of her performance.
So is it nerve-wracking for you to be working a movie this way, or is it that the joy of this particular experience?
Yes. All of it. It was nerve-wracking. Movies are nerve-wracking. They're giant things. They can fail, and you can have a stupid idea, you putting your neck on the line. At the same time, if you trust people and you trust your team and you trust the human race, when you set out, crazy amazing things happen. I drove through a town in New Mexico one day in the car, and all of a sudden a Native American man ran out from the side of the road, and he starts hailing down the vehicle, full of energy, bright eyes and sparkling, and he comes up to the car and he said to me, "Is this Elvis Presley's car?" I'm just driving. I mean, granted, it's a silver Rolls Royce, but it's not the only silver Rolls Royce in the world.
Right.
How did he know it was Elvis Presley's car? And this wasn't a planned stop. So I was like, this is bizarre. Pull over. Okay, how did you know that? Well, we know everything about Elvis Presley, he said. My wife and I And he told me about their tribal history and how they knew that Elvis was part Native American. And she had a cookbook of Elvis recipes. She brought it from the house, the recipes she makes that were Elvis's favorite recipes for this or that, or chicken fried this or chicken fried that. And we had this incredible conversation, and I brought them for a ride in the car. And I spent the better part of a day with those guys. And they brought me to a park, and all of a sudden in that park, there was a Native American man under a tree with his horse. So we went over and talked to him, and he was a healer from the state of Missouri who was wandering around America with his horse. And he's in the film, very briefly, a beautiful set of shots of this mirage of a man. And it's like, you can't script that. And that we weren't even supposed to drive through that town. It was a detour. Because of some shut down part of the interstate. So the movie resonates that realness of the American story, and the beauty of the American experience is, of course, set against my anguish and my outrage at the way in which the American dream has been compromised, the way in which the democratic hopes of the American people have been compromised. But the movie is a love letter to the country that could be and the country that ought to be. Country that a lot of us have in our hearts, the world that a lot of us have in our hearts. That's the other thing. You drive through this country in the car, and you've never seen so many American flags. You've never seen so many flags in any country in the world. There's no country in the world that's a Western democracy that hangs the flag as everywhere as we do. And you really see that when you drive across this country in a slow-moving vehicle like that. And it tells you something about a certain insecurity about who we are. America is not comfortable with herself right now, and I hope the conversations we've had with the film and the way the film will reach people helps to improve the conversation where we can figure out who do we want to be and how do we get there.
And it's significant, I think. I mean, a lot of the press about the movie has, you know, gone directly to Trump, but it seems like it really is more than Trump for you.
Much.
Yeah.
I mean, Trump is a toxin that we're all having to deal with. And he's a toxin who's appeals to the profound frustration of a certain subset of the population who have reason to be frustrated, and they have figured out the wrong solutions. So they're in the hate thy neighbor mode. And Trump fuels hate thy neighbor thinking. That's why he has now set up concentration camps for juveniles at the border. No one but someone who is fueling hate thy neighbor thinking.
Yeah.
Would engage in that kind of unchristian, inhumane, un-American, un-anything except fascist behavior. So, everything is more important for us to talk about than Donald Trump. Donald Trump just is a magnifier on things that have been deeply wrong with this country for a long time. He's a horrible magnifier, but in fact, many ways, the result of Trump has been some of the most significant social movements I've seen in my lifetime in reaction against him. And so while he is horrible, and while I think he's an awful human being, the moment right now that we're living through is deeply inspiring to me. Mm-hmm. Look at Emma Gonzalez and the Parkland students. Look at Black Lives Matter. Look at Time's Up, Me Too. The teacher walkouts in several states where their strikes got better working conditions for teachers. Everywhere we look, the courts, the media, so much is actually doing its job suddenly in a democracy. And everyday people. My accountant sent me an email this morning about his outrage about the children being ripped from their mothers. Well, it woke my accountant up, and he spends the rest of his life buried in the facts and figures of this capitalist society. So there's something in all that, and it's an amazing moment to be living through.
What does it puts us the flashlight or the light, the Klieg light, it's put on democracy and how it actually is.
Yes.
And what the laws actually are versus what we were all comfortable with the idea of believing in, not realizing how vulnerable we were to, you know.
The trailer came out about a week ago online, the trailer for the film, and it blew me away. We've had hundreds of thousands of people watch the trailer. It was very surprising, big explosion in the trailer. Great. The weird thing is, go read the comments. It is an unmitigated stream of hate mail. I've taken on the military-industrial complex. I took on George W. Bush. I asked whether Henry Kissinger was a war criminal. I took Ronald Reagan down a peg or two or three. I accuse the country of running the drug war as a form of genocide against black people. I've never gotten the kind of hate mail that I'm receiving for just having Chuck D in my trailer about Elvis.
God.
For just saying to Americans, it's possible that you're drinking Kool-Aid on some things, generally, on who we are.
Yeah.
And it's okay, we don't have to keep drinking Kool-Aid. We can grow up and we can take responsibility for ourselves and for how this is all going to go.
Mm.
And people are very upset at Trump and they're very willing to change this specific or that specific. But until we start to look deep within ourselves at what? At our incredible obsession with power and money as a society. Look at how many people just watched the royal wedding. This is a democracy that broke off from the King of England, never to have a kings and queens again.
Yep.
And we are obsessed with kings and queens. Mike Myers in the film makes this incredibly funny point about he can never understand as a Canadian why Americans are so in love with royalty, right? The king of this, the king of that, that. We call everything the king of beers, muffler king, Elvis the king. And then he talks about Bruce Springsteen is called the boss. Don't we hate the boss? Why would we call Bruce Springsteen the boss if we love Bruce Springsteen? What kind of the people, by the people, for the people country has such an obsession with putting our certain people on a pedestal?
Yeah.
In that way, it's counter to democracy. And that's why partly the movie is called The King, and that's why I drove his Rolls Royce. That's why I didn't drive a Cadillac or a Thunderbird or sort of an American dream machine.
Mm-hmm.
I drove a machine that represents when the country boy has gone off script and tried to become a king, became a king, and lost himself.
Mm. It's interesting. There was a New Yorker, I think it was a New Yorker piece, maybe 8 months before the election, about how the idea, the theory that a country could not elect a Donald Trump if it was in real crisis, but that in somehow the comfort zone that America has found itself, the weird kind of like degree of comfort that we have, but the anguish that is still churning at the same time is what leads to the kind of disaffection that would allow us to take a risk on, you know, the people would take a risk on a guy like Trump, who clearly doesn't have the qualifications or the skills, but is at least a leap in the dark into to something other, that people are still obsessed with the other, even though they're 80% satisfied or 85% satisfied.
I think that the best way to look at America and Trump is he's like a rebound guy. The population of this country was abused for decades and decades by an increasingly winner-take-all 1% driven society, 0.00001% driven society, so that people know that they're being fooled, they know that their purchasing power has shrunk, they know that their lives are harder and harder and less rewarding and less fair, and they're striking out. They want anything but what has gotten them to that point. So it's almost like a beaten spouse who says, I'm so tired of being abused. The next person who walks in that door and says anything other than what I keep hearing, I'll go with them. And so the next fool walked in the door, and there he is. And so they just signed on with a rescue by a crook.
Yeah.
He's just a con man who seized on the vulnerability of a population of desperate people.
But it's fascinating that almost everything he pushed and continues to push are issues that really were not major issues in this country. He's hit the obsession with immigration, particularly from the southern border, which is truly a non-issue at the point which he got elected.
He needs non-issues to traffic in the kind of chaos that lets him control a dialogue that without that chaos, he doesn't have the expertise to control. So he needs the world to be a card table that got thrown upside down, because now none of the experts can find the monopoly pieces either. It's a shit show. And therefore, he can move in and say, well, I'm as expert as you guys are. Step aside. I've got the pulpit. He likes chaos. Any fascist likes chaos. It's a vacuum into which they can step. And I think in his particular case, the particular peril that we're running into is that we really don't have healthy and trustable, believable alternatives in this country that have yet the kind of momentum they need to capture the passion of the public to find another way. So the public had lost faith in the system so badly, and a real alternative needs to step up. I think what Donald Trump represents in a certain way is like, you know, well, I don't want to talk about Donald Trump anymore, really. In fact, I mean, Donald Trump is, he's hasn't he done enough? Let's just say what we need to do is to figure out how we want this place to look with or without him. How did we want it before he came in and simply became the sum of all fears? He becomes this symbol of things that are wrong with us already. And
it could have been a false prophet of sunshine instead of darkness, in theory. And people would have been just as attracted.
Yeah,
I mean, it sounds like Obama. I don't know that Obama was quite as much. I don't think he was a false prophet in quite the same way. But he was, you know, the cult of personality and that need to attach to somebody, as you said.
Yeah,
it doesn't really matter who it is.
You know, I don't think it's something. The passion that I have for Elvis is that Emmylou Harris at one point in the film talks about how Elvis was the first person really to whom this kind of megastar power happened. And that it's therefore one has to have some compassion for this young man who suddenly is a colossus astride the globe, has the whole world in his hand. How's he supposed to know what to do with it? And who among us would have the personal integrity or resilience to be able to withstand the seductions that were put before him? We spoke to a girlfriend of his who said every 5 minutes when this guy took a breath, somebody was there to say, I want to be with you. You know, and the millions of moments in his life that the rest of us will never face of unbelievable pressure and opportunity and all of that seduction. And he was seduced by it. And that's understandable. My goal is not to condemn Elvis Presley for anything. My goal is to see in him, who people care about very, very much, a cautionary tale that we are all Elvis. We are all facing those vulnerabilities, those seductions. You know, I know that Facebook is bad for life. I know that it's bad for our interaction with each other. I know that it cheapens and selfies and denigrates life as we know it. How long after I leave this interview do you think it'll be before I check my Facebook? So I'm not immune from this. All of us, we all are sucked into patterns of behavior and decisions, and we're all victims in a way because all of this happened to us and none of us, we're still kids in the playground. All this kind of befell us. I don't know how the hell we ended up with these lives we don't understand. So we're victims in one way, but we also make choices all along the way within that condition, and those choices can be different, and that's the only thing we can control. Everybody who loved Elvis said if only we could have gotten through to him, he was making grown-up choices. He went for these things. You know, Ethan Hawke spells it out in the film. Jerry Schilling spelled it out to me in many interviews, Elvis's best friend. That these are choices Elvis made, even though we understand he was victimized, which he was. Where does that line end, and where does your own free will and choice begin, and how do we, in our own ways, make better on that?
Well, it's interesting because almost all of your films, I think all of all of your films, really, deal with a period before this wave of digital access and the internet and everything else becoming so dominant in our lives and the way we connect it. And this film, Elvis is a reflection of that. But now, as you're saying, it seems like we're all Elvis on some level because we have access to everything, you know, this cornucopia of stuff that is beyond our really ability to manage.
But doesn't feed the soul.
Yeah.
Water everywhere and not a drop to drink.
Though you don't know, I mean, some things, I guess, do feed the soul, but you don't know, it's hard to differentiate which is which. I mean, you can say it on the outside, in the outside version, but on the other hand, there's probably something good about Facebook for you that does feed the soul. And 90% of it may not, 95% of it may not, but you're getting something somewhere.
I can't tell, and it takes some time to figure out, what things you do in life that later on you find out were reflexes and addictions, and which ones were health food. And I think the art of living is figuring out the difference and figuring out how to engage in the healthful stuff.
And was working this way on this movie that for you?
More so than in the past. This was a less self-destructive process, you would think. And in fact, it's funny because when the idea for the movie came to me, I knew that Elvis had died at 42. I learned that. I was 42. And I thought, well, that's weird. I'm in the middle of what I think feels like a midlife crisis. Like, I am asking myself a lot of questions about who I am, what it's all about, why I do what I do. And it dawned on me that I think the country was in a midlife crisis. That this country, you know, you talk to Europeans, they always like to tell you, oh, America's such a young country. They don't really say that anymore because we feel a little older than we used to. This country's had it's become more threadbare. A lot of our, you know, a lot of the things that were young and beautiful about us have gotten a little bit like imperial and heavy, and we got 800 military bases in the world, and that's no spring chicken and things like that. So,
and we're the only ones.
Yeah, no. And we've just become so much like that, that we're not young anymore, but we're certainly not one of the old countries. So we're in midlife. And I think in that midlife phase, we're doing all the things like buying the convertible and crashing it into a tree. You know, we're doing all that weird pros and cons. We do one good thing, we do one bad thing. You know, we're the best at this, we're the worst at that. And that's understandable, and I'm part of that, and we all need to have compassion for ourselves in order to get better. There's no sense just being brutal about this, but there's a lot of room for improvement now. And that room for improvement, in my view, is fueled by an understanding of the rise and fall of Elvis, because we see in the rise and fall of Elvis that Elvis missed a chance. He missed a chance to let the best in him shine.
Has anybody not missed that chance?
Yeah, I do occasionally see people. I saw Natalie Portman in an interview last week. And Natalie Portman, I think for many, many years, was a proponent of a pretty simple view of what was going on in Israel. And I watched Natalie Portman do the math on that publicly in front of a world of people and took an incredibly meaningful and effective and respectful position about the complexity of that situation, and particularly about the pain that is being felt by the people of Palestine. And I say this as a Jewish person. Watching someone evolve and watching someone be... I watched her also make comments about Jared Kushner, who she apparently went to high school with or something like that. And she was bold and clear, and she didn't do that Washington to Hollywood shuffle where nothing gets to be called like it should be. A lie is a lie.
Yeah.
Corruption is a corruption, and an abuse is an abuse. And I really admired watching her do that. I felt like I was watching somebody come of age, somebody in my generation get to the next thought and show you, hey, John Maynard Keynes was once accused of flip-flopping, The Economist. And he said, well, sir, he said, when I get new information, I change my views. What, sir, do you do with new information? And I think we all need to grow. And if we do grow, we'd want to grow toward the mindful, the kind, and the healthy. Nobody on their deathbed says, I wish I had been less kind.
Oh, I guess that's, I mean, you were...
Maybe Trump.
Well.
He may say, gosh, I really should have set up a few more juvenile concentration camps.
But the irony of the Trump thing and of the people who, and some of the people who follow him, and some of the people who agree with him, really agree with him, which I find hard to imagine even sometimes. But there's something broken. And there's a sympathy, I mean, outside of the fact that he's now he's in a position to inflict this upon millions of people, you have to look at that guy and go, there's something deeply fucked up about that human being that I should feel great sympathy for, because he needs to act out in this way, and he needs to convince himself so desperately. He became president of the United States, and he's still empty. He's still trying to fill a hole.
That's correct.
And it's so sad. I mean, it's profoundly sad outside of the fact that he's also destroying lives.
Right. I mean, Donald Trump is the opposite of Elvis Presley. He is the embodiment of everything that destroyed Elvis Presley, period. I understand why some people, when they see the movie, think that there's a metaphor in Trump about Elvis. But all that's about is how America went sequined, gold-plated, cheap, Vegas, vulgar. That happened to the country to a degree, and that happened to Elvis Presley. But once again, that stuff comes naturally to Trump. Yeah. That stuff invaded Elvis Presley's life. It's very different.
And he's physically, I mean, in the weird way, I mean, the way as watching the movie and also other stuff with Elvis is like the decline is very much, seems to feel like he wanted that decline on some level at that point. There was a degree of self-destruction that he was into, whereas Trump is thriving on that ugliness.
Well, it's funny, if you're a person to whom the whole world becomes available, the only original thing you can do in a certain sense is devolve. It's like that Chet Baker, Let's Get Lost, you know? He's already got everything, so what's he going to do? Make himself look even better in the mirror? He already looks good enough.
Right.
Make some more hit records? He's already made those. So, in a weird way, the only way out is dark. I mean, that may be, and in a certain sense, every other thing is expectable. And every other thing is a pressure, and every other thing is part of the Faustian bargain. where you know that there's a hollowness. So it's understandable that someone starts to self-medicate, as he did. And I think America self-medicates in the same way. I think this is a society that feels confusion and being overwhelmed. And people, this is one of the most addicted societies in history, and it's for a reason.
Well, and being the singular power on Earth since Russia fell,
yeah,
is a weight that I think people don't even think about.
I'll tell you a funny version of this, okay? I'm not a drug taker, but I've got all kinds of addictions. I've been addicted to food my whole life. We all have things we do addictively. And if yours is drugs and mine is this, it's the same. It's a tendency, you got to fill a hole and you're trying to fill that hole. Do you know that about 3 months ago, I had a day where I had a head cold. I didn't feel good. It was really hazy. And went to sleep. And in the middle of the night, I've been coughing like crazy. So I got out of bed, went into the bathroom, took some cough syrup, went back to sleep. I woke up the next day, and it had just been a one day, like one of those 24-hour things. So I wake up the next day, and I feel a lot better. In fact, I felt fantastic. And I got on the phone, and I started calling like everybody I knew. And I had these wonderful conversations with everybody. They were the best conversations you've ever heard in your life. People said to me, what's gotten into you? You're in an incredibly good mood, which made me think I must be like a terrible mood all the time or whatever. But my kids, they said, you're like a different person. It's fantastic. You know what I figured out? I OD'd on cough syrup. Mm. That was the nicest feeling I've had in years. People said to me, apparently you ought to take drugs because you're much funnier, much more charming, much more likable on drugs. Well, what does that tell you? That tells you that I, in the middle of making this Elvis movie, in the middle of trying to understand the society's need to self-medicate this and that, apparently I needed that self-medication. I've been in a better mood ever since. I haven't taken any more of the cough syrup, but it taught me, holy cow, you're carrying a weight.
Yeah.
You're carrying the weight of what you were hoping to be, what you're hoping to get done, what is happening in the world, what you hope for your kids and your loved ones. And it's all so much weight. And that happened to all of us. And they don't prep you for it in kindergarten. They don't tell you that in high school. They don't let you know. It's really going to be tough out there. They say it, but it's not like it is now. And I'm a comfortable person. I'm not a poor person. Mm-hmm. You talk about somebody who's poor and you add all that to it, people are in pain. So Elvis is a very natural, understandable vision because he's all the way up there and he's in pain and makes the wrong choices. And we all have that as an equalizer, that the choices we make are going to be a huge factor. Some of it will be beyond our control. All we can do is fix what we can control.
But it's just stunning how we sublimate that. And, you know, the Kardashianism of the world and all of that is like, you know, maybe they're happy and maybe they're perfect and maybe they're wonderful and maybe they love each other and all that stuff. But it's like the idea of how we, I guess it's medication, because self-medicating is that, you know, the idea of embracing the image of somebody else having more and that being an aspiration and thinking, I think people truly think that other people don't carry those burdens. And maybe Elvis, because he was so poor,
sure,
and he was one of them for long enough,
yep,
that there became a break in it at some point. But it's one of the most horrifying things about Facebook and all that too, is that we have this communication tool where we can connect to the world in a way we never had before at all, not even close to it.
Yeah,
you know, my father grew up talking about toll calls,
right,
until he died in 1980 something. But it's like, We use it to look in the mirror some more, to fantasize about things and not to...
Yep, yep.
Or just a bitch even, you know, even that.
There's also an element of Stockholm Syndrome in all this. Like, one of the things we're going to have to break free from in American life is we have been in the system we're in for long enough, even though we're not such an old country, that we don't know that another way exists. If you walk into the room and you're me and you question capitalism and you question the winner-take-all nature of American society that has rich people not paying taxes and poor people scrambling to make a living and keep their kids alive, people look at you like you're a crazy communist who wants to overthrow the system. Well, you might just want to be somebody who thinks we ought to have a democracy, and if we're going to have some capitalism in our economy, it ought to be regulated so it doesn't ruin the democracy. Is that weird? That would seem like the most normal thing in the world. That's where the entire history of the country came from. That's what the New Deal was about. That's what the New Deal made America the most powerful country in the world doing. So it's only in the past 60 or 70 years that the wealthy and their lobbyists and representatives have sort of taught the country to identify with their captor. Like, we don't even understand how to rethink a system that might overthrow the ruling class. Well, why don't you want to overthrow the ruling class? They're the ones who are keeping you hungry and marginalized and disenfranchised. Well, because they're the ruling class, and if they don't have the chance, then maybe I won't have. The idea of trickle-down opportunity, which is even loonier than trickle-down economics, it's never happened that way. So we have to unlearn that, and it means spitting out some Kool-Aid. We're very accustomed to drinking.
See, I believe in the idea that it's actually because we've lived without real crisis as a nation, even though there are people starving, even though there are people in real danger and crisis, that as a nation without having had a war like Vietnam, since Vietnam, and the switch with Nixon and everything else that happened in that moment, that somehow we've been coasting relatively comfortable. The rich have kept people fed enough to be revolutionary, for not to be extreme, and that somehow we're comfortable. And, if you talk to somebody who makes $30,000 a year, somebody who makes $80,000 a year, they're all complaining about the same thing, $120,000 a year. Right. It's never enough for any of them.
Right.
They all feel like they're starving. Some people actually are starving.
Yeah.
But we forget they even exist because they live in another part of the city.
Yep. I mean, I first of all, I think crisis is coming. I think it's self-evident when you listen to people like Bill Gates protecting mass pandemics and things like that. And you look at what just happened in Hawaii. The rule of thumb throughout history is that crisis is a constant. And if we've been lucky enough to duck some comprehensive crises for some time, we're living in a sort of self-delusion bubble. So I think crisis will come. The question is, how prepared are we for it? And what, for example, Naomi Klein's shock doctrine is very interesting, because what she's saying is, beware when the next crisis comes, how the ghoulish profiteers will descend on that crisis and turn a horrible situation for those most directly affected into a massively more horrible exploitation experience where, these Bangladeshi coastal fisher people have just had their huts flooded. Get them out of here. Let's put a wall up and put some major hotels here. Mm-hmm. So it's a shock doctrine, the idea of disaster capitalism. Well, we need to recognize what she's talking about. And then we need to go the next step, which is to say, okay, well, how do we want to be prepared for disaster? What do we want to say to the public about who put you in this disaster? Who made you vulnerable to this disaster? Spike Lee's response, for example, to what happened in New Orleans when the levees broke. The right reaction to New Orleans is, who forsook the people of New Orleans? Who let this happen? Who has turned a sort of blind eye to the needs of some part of the population to leave them vulnerable to this kind of thing? So we're going to need to develop a real sort of media literacy and situational savvy about what's coming and how to respond to it and how to put point the right fingers in the right directions to the right pressure points to make real change. Ideally, you get out ahead of these crises and say, there is a crisis coming. There probably was one dinosaur who turned to the other and said, don't you think it's getting a little cold than it was? No, they're just reporting it more, said the other dinosaur.
Fake news.
Yeah, it's fake news. Pay no attention. Just get a coat.
Well, the real estate crisis is an example of that, where it's like somehow we came out worse because somehow everybody survived it. The banks are thriving. We now have a bank on every corner, right next to every Starbucks.
Amazing.
I mean, they have so much real estate, it's crazy, and yet they're not giving money to consumers. There's all this money for commercial real estate.
Well, that's the Stockholm Syndrome. We keep having dress rehearsal crises, and we find a way of putting off solution. So every time we have a crisis, they do some tweak in policy that's not meant to solve the problem, it's meant to quiet the symptoms. So we keep taking more and more cough syrup.
So how did you know when you were done?
Because the film looks at America through the prism of Elvis's life, I knew we were done when Elvis's life had ended, and when I was left to process its full implications for where we are now. And I thought I had done that to a degree by the time we went to Cannes with the film, but I knew the film wasn't finished. And then over the months between then and now is when the full picture of where I think we are and where we're going was able to take shape. And at a certain point, we finished a film that I think you could watch in 10 years and it would still be relevant.
Did you know, but I mean, when you actually finished shooting, were you, was there a day where you went, I mean, was it a schedule? Was it a
I remember the last shoot day, and it had a unbelievably poetic element. It was very hard to process. We were in Las Vegas, and sort of all of these tragic American stories end in Vegas one way or another. And we were in a casino, and I saw somebody at a slot machine. And the person was disabled. They were in a wheelchair, and it was a motorized wheelchair. And they looked like a person of very compromised health. And, you know, the slot machines these days, they've cut out any pretense that there's luck involved. They don't even have an arm. You know, I used to go in there, pull it halfway down, and hit the machine, then do it again. I do a dance like Kramer, you know, all kinds of systems. Mm-hmm. Now there's none of that. You just push a button, and it's saying to you, I am a computer. I am designed to take more of your money than I will give you. And so that uncut relationship is what you see on display across Vegas. It's a town that preys on the weaknesses of human beings. And I'd already been so outraged by the many versions I saw of that. We were with drug addicts in Vegas, and there was with, you know, sex professionals in Vegas, and we were filming all kinds of people in Vegas for the film. And I got into this last moment where I was walking out of the casino, and there was this person, and this was a slot machine that didn't even take coins. It only took cards, ATM cards. So this person had their ATM card, but it wasn't in their pocket. It was attached to a lanyard, and the lanyard led up to the slot of the slot machine where the ATM card could go in. And this person was just pushing the button over and over with their money being sucked through this umbilical cord between that machine and their bank account, cutting out all the middlemen. Just watch my bank account go down now. Stay tuned. And at that point I said, we got to get out of here. I got a lot of movie to tell, and it's not only about this.
And did you feel confident that you would gotten everything you needed, as it were?
We shot about 2,600 hours of material for the movie, and the movie is 2 hours long, or an hour and 45 minutes long. So it couldn't take any more, because this is a big subject, and the movie's got to be a certain length, so that when people leave the theater, they still have a lot of energy left to go change the world.
But was there any, I mean, was there a sense even within the process, in the middle of it or whatever, of, I mean, obviously people shoot a movie with a script and they're, you know, oh, that shot didn't quite work, we got to go back and get that or whatever. Right. Was there any sense of what you were getting, or that you were trying to define it in any way? Was the whole experience about putting pieces together and letting it fly?
A bit of both. We, along the way, of course, we had made ourselves open to circumstance because it would make the film more exciting. But a script emerges. It's an emergent narrative. And as that narrative begins to take shape, all of a sudden it becomes more and more imposing on what you then shoot. So suddenly the later shoots, you have more of a clear sense of what you want, because it relates back to something else you did. Now you're asking for this. And I wouldn't tell you that those choices are always the most inspired. Sometimes they feel a little bit like, what happened to the cool old jazz me who was riffing on all this? Now I'm like trying to put it in 4/4 time and make it have all kinds of themes and all of that. So a bit of that is artful, and you can feel some of it in the film. And I think there are moments, the theme of Moby Dick comes up in the film several times. And some of the exploration we did about the link between Moby Dick and Elvis was interesting. But if we went too far with it, as we did in certain cuts, you'd kind of feel this is getting a little too thematic. This wants to let the audience do the math themselves and come to their own feelings themselves. So it was all a balancing act. But I was very, as we got toward the very end, it did become clearer and clearer, enough is enough.
And was the post for you one of the easier ones, or was it harder, or?
Staggeringly complex. Much more than ever before. So five editors on the film.
Because every time you move the Jenga piece, right. The other one...
Yes, because these films are built like a million little Moroccan tiles. They're not built in bricks. And we don't narrate them. We don't sort of cheat. We let the story play out. You know, whenever you go to see a movie, whenever that narrator starts talking, mm-hmm. I always think, God, there must have been something about the screenplay they didn't solve. Because otherwise, this person wouldn't be telling me this right now, because it's not very cinematic. If I want that, I can go to a reading. Or go read a book. But if I'm going to watch a movie, it's because I want to not know what's around that corner. And we wanted to preserve that here.
Somebody asked me about that we were talking about a subject and why it hadn't had a good documentary. I said there was a great documentarian, did it, but he ended up in the movie, which tells you he failed.
Yeah.
You know, he's great, he's brilliant, but he just couldn't get what he needed to get to make it work as a film.
And in my case, I'm in this movie because I drive the car, but boy, you know, the rule in the editing room was keep me at a minimum. Because there's so much to cover here. And all you need to know is that someone is driving that car, so you're not wondering, is it being pulled by a rig or something? So we kept my little shoulder in there to be driving sometimes so that you knew we weren't going to crash.
Well, and also there are pieces about the journey itself and you know, the people making the car go and fixing things and whatever.
Trying to figure out if they know what they're doing.
Yeah. Well, it keeps us on the journey. That's what keeps the journey alive, almost more than the car driving.
Yeah.
Is the people who are making the car drive.
Very much, very much.
Yeah. So with you five editors, you have the film festival coming up, you have all of that. How did you know you were done with cutting?
Before Cannes or before Sundance?
Well,
those were different.
Yes, both.
Okay, before Cannes, I knew we weren't done, but I knew it was worthy to show to the world at that moment. France was facing what had this near-death experience they'd had almost electing Marine Le Pen, and we had elected Trump, and the movie speaks to what goes wrong in democratic, idyllic, dream societies. How does it get broken? How does that dream get broken? So I thought it was worthy to show there, and I was very honored that Khan was going to show it. We then knew this film's not going to come out for a while, and the world is changing very quickly. And the film has a very flammable relationship with current events. You know, like I tell you, if you go on, look at how people view the trailer, they view this like I've attacked the most immediate, forget Scientology, this thing is 1,000 times more flammable, the institution of what Elvis and the 50s represent about what certain people want to cling to in the American legend. And I knew that it was going to take us many months to handle all of the sensitivities that have been so aggravated by the way modern politics and modern coverage of politics seeks agitation, seeks heat instead of light.
Mm. And so you went to Cannes.
So,
and then you were go back in for 6 weeks, or what was your...
We edited the film for 8 more months after Cannes.
8 more months, okay.
Yeah. We were editing from May until the end of the year, right until before Sundance.
Now,
the amount of editing that went in that time was a lot. We took about 20 minutes out of the film, and we changed a lot of the fabric and the feeling of the film. The core vision of the film did not change, but my perspective on what's happening in the world changed. So by the time I finished that film, you had a deeply optimistic, idealistic person again making the film. Whatever sort of disillusionment I felt going into Cannes, how could I possibly maintain that as we're releasing the film now, having seen all of the things that have happened since? You know, the Parkland students, how can you be the same filmmaker before they've entered your life or after? So,
And
different
cough syrup.
Film. Say again.
And the cough syrup.
And a bit of cough syrup.
So, when you locked that cut that went to Sundance,
yep,
you were at peace with it?
Yeah, you know, when I finish my films, I'm at peace with them. It takes me a long time to get them where I want to get them, and I receive a lot of feedback from strangers and friends, and I think these are a communication medium, so it's not like I say, there is my art. You must take it. Mm-hmm. It's like, I don't know, what do you think of it? I didn't think of that. then I have to go back and that person said that thing. Well, I don't want to be entirely be pushed around by what you said, but it was something really smart in it. Let me think of that. So I'm a bit like a kleptomaniac, you know? And by the time it's done, it's been idiot-proofed and genius-proofed and every other proof you could have. I put them through a lot of paces. My team always wants to call my company No Stone Unturned because, man, we try every full thing you can think of to try to make the strongest movie we can that does the most good. Mm. I mean, I sound naive. I start to realize I sound like a goody two-shoes in the world, but I don't know what the hell else to be. There's enough nefarious shit out there. Like, I have no interest in being... I don't have a particular interest in being a cool person. Like, I've never understood... I mean, I wanted to be cool in high school. I dressed like Elvis in high school, like, which wasn't cool then, by the way, at all. So I didn't quite have it right.
Gold LeMay in high school.
Yeah, it wasn't quite the thing. But I've wanted to be cool at times in my life, but I've just started to realize that cool is cold. It's lonely. It's not going to move us forward. You know, I try to tell this to my kids, too, because they're trying to figure out who they want to be, and they're really wonderful. They're not just trying to be cool, and that's a great thing to see in this generation. That's why I was so moved. I've been so moved by the Parkland kids, and I've been moved in so many other directions where you see real truth to power, not just at a kind of media level, but like real, I'm fed up and I'm not going to take this, and I'm going to exercise some dignity here.
If I've learned anything in recovering all this industry for so long, it's that the artist is the artist. that you can't escape the person if they're any good. If it's surface and it's junk and it's whatever, easy to be a craftsman and just go do the work. But when you talk to people who are artists and you have, you know, Errol and Steven on your as executive producers and whatever, there's no escaping who they are. And somehow they have to find a way to you know, navigate the world that they live in. As Steven has wandered through different forms of, you know, presentation, and Errol is now working in, you know, this mixture of of drama, of narrative, and documentary, and all that. But there's no choice, and that's you know, ultimately, if you want to be Little Miss Sunshine, it's because you, in your heart, I just want to be Little Miss Sunshine.
My mom always said to me that I had a sunshiny nature growing up, and she noticed that I ended up making such serious films, and she often says, are you ever going to make a feel-good film? And I have felt good trying to shed light on injustice because, as Martin Luther King said, the long arc of history bends toward justice, and we're all supposed to be, or at least I felt like life was supposed to be about pushing to better this world. And I still think that, and it makes me feel good to be part of that, just as I would feel, you know, you litter. When we were younger, you throw something out the window, and 30 seconds later, you think, God, why did I do that? You know? So I don't want to litter. I don't want to leave this place worse than I found it. That would be such a waste of a life. I just feel like the ultimate loser. So I do want to do some good. The question for me when you talk about being an artist or not is, I've never been able to figure out if I'm an artist or an operative. Mm. You know? And I'm somewhere in between. If I didn't think that these movies could better this world, I think I'd find another way to be helpful, because that's what I was sort of born to do. And for the moment, these have seemed like a way to help the public conversation, offer ideas and tools and sort of almost brands for certain ways of thinking that they're like, you know, devices that we can use to make ourselves get forward. Like when Malcolm Gladwell introduced a tipping point, you're like, okay, the tipping point, that plays into my thinking. Now there's a new term of art for this kind of negotiating strategy that the Trump people do, where they ask for 20,000 times what anyone would ever ask for before, and then when you negotiate back, you suddenly discover the whole center of gravity of the negotiation shift. Well, that's a term of art that'll move us backward, because people will do it, and that'll hurt the world. So it's a contest of trying to make the world better against that which tries to make it worse. And I've always been very proud to be part of that. To the extent I feel joy in life, it's in getting the art right in the service of that. And I hope that's what audiences get from the movie.
Well, everybody wasn't quoting Eisenhower before you.
That's true. We've done a few things where we like introduced something, but that's because I got the soapbox and I used the soapbox to do something that brought a certain kind of thinking together. And in this case, if Americans could think, this happened to Elvis and it ought not happen to this country, That's a great thing to think. That's a very romantic, beautiful thing to think, and it means certain specific choices follow from that. And they move us back toward democracy. They move us away from the false exaltation of power and money.
Well, I think the journey of this film for most audiences will be subtextual as much as anything else. And when the text rises to their brain at some point, when they're having a conversation with somebody, saying something they didn't think they were going to say, that's when it'll be manifest itself. But I think that that's one of the things that's so wonderful about the film, is that it's the experience you have when you cross country in a car, when you take the time to breathe, when you're hearing voices that you don't hear every minute of every day, yeah, and not in the, you know, in 140 characters or 280 yeah characters. I think it's almost, it was fat. I read a couple of the reviews the other day, and it was like watching the critics even wrestle with that notion and how uncomfortable it made them, clearly,
yeah,
to not have an answer when they walked out of the movie theater.
Right.
You know, but that's when something's happening, I think.
I hope so.
I think in the best films, you know, any year, really, whether documentaries or features or narratives or whatever we're calling them, if you walk out of the theater and you have it, it's not as good a film as the film where you walk out of the theater and you're not sure what the fuck happened.
I think so too. And that's somewhat hard to do as a filmmaker because it's not so rewarding in the sense that it's hard to leave people with work to do. You want to leave people with the answer, and you want them to say, you're the brilliant guy who gave me the answer. Go pat yourself on the back. But if you leave off and you say, we're in a work in progress place here, and this is a poetical, whimsical journey through that world, but you've got to go from here. It's like dropping your kid off at school for the first time. You know, you've done what you can do to a point, and you've provided some ideas, but there's a whole life out there to be lived.
Well, if this movie had a big flashing light, then it would be a failure, I think.
Say again?
If this movie had a big flashing light telling you what to think, it would be a failure.
I think so. Yeah, I think so. And I've gotten, you know, I mean, that's come with time in my life. I've noticed that the movie titles I always love the most are the ones where you have to finish the thought, so the harder they come. It's a fantastic movie title because you are engaged already. It's an interactive movie title. You finish that thought in your mind. You know, my brother made a movie, All Good Things. You finish that thought in your mind, you know?
Well, I think that's true actually of movies too. I think that, I mean, it's always kind of blame Hitchcock for it, but I think that the biggest failure of the modern cinema is the urge to fill every hole. And that's the movies where the audience actually has the opportunity to participate and to anticipate and be wrong and be right and all those things. So that's the joyous experience.
Yeah.
Nobody wants to go in and just be fed oatmeal.
Yeah.
Unless you're
yeah
six or whatever and yes just pretty pictures.
Yeah.
But adults, even like we think people, I think, underestimate people and that the capacity to
yeah
to discover.
That was one thing we did in the recutting of the movie, by the way, was there was a, this happens to everybody's movies, but there was, of course, 100 things which we had said one beat too many. Or it's like, I got it. I understand this one. You don't have to keep telling me the same. Just because that person said it in a cool way, or just because that situation brought it out in a cool way, you'd already established this. So the movie tried to be as efficient as possible in keeping the road trip moving at the speed of a road trip and not stopping to have too many Mount Rushmore talking heads in a row.
Which could be very seductive, because it's like, there was a documentary that I won't name on camera, but that, you know, it was like, it was so brilliantly loaded with stuff.
Yeah.
And yet it was like, this needs to be a miniseries, because it's so yeah much stuff, it's incoherent.
Yeah.
You know, it's just not actually, it lost the view of what it was actually trying to say.
Yeah.
And just became, and all, I like every single talking head, and yet wanted half of them.
Are you describing my film?
I'm not, ironically. But when I tell you off camera what it is, it'll be very close to your heart. Anyway, so do you know what's next already, or are you kind of breathing for a minute?
I'm breathing for a moment, and I'll be taking this film all over on the road. And so it's the road trip about the road trip.
And what is you, when you go in front of an audience, what are you hoping for?
Well, I've had some audience interactions so far, just a few times, at Sundance and in Nashville, and the movie opened in Germany. And there's an amazing sense of intensity about how people perceive the movie. And I found very strong, very positive reaction from people. Occasionally, I've had some people walk out of this movie, and I am wondering, what are they so upset about? Like, what am I touching on here? And I'm not trying to be coy. Like, this is, to a degree, a walk down memory lane. This is yesterday. You may not agree with this, but you're going to walk out? We haven't had too much of that, but when we have it, it speaks to a passion. The flip side of which is, last night we had a screening here in L.A., and, you know, I have people who come up in tears, you know, because the themes that the movie is dealing with mean a great deal to people. How this all ends up here means a great deal to people. And they know it's... the story has not yet fully been written.
I guess it never will be, no one. Thank you for your time. Appreciate it. Pleasure to see you.